Oh, that's delicious. Those chips are good.
Hey, we could use one of these on top of the hanger.
I do want this on top of the... Oh, let's see what's Ron doing. Hi, Ron.
It's physics, math, and engineering. Machine it, draft it, build it, test it, break it. Every time something new gets built, the entire world advances. Laying in bed at night, it's designing new parts, designing new suspension, designing new wings.
Hey guys, we're gonna do something a little different today. We did a really fun project, Mark and I, with Garmin because we missed Oshkosh. We did a live Q&A, and because of where it was published, a lot of you that are on my channel didn't get to see it. So check it out. I hope you like this. We're gonna get right back to work. Hello, everyone. Hi, I'm Mike Patey.
I'm Mark Patey.
Welcome to Garmin's virtual Oshkosh experience. We wanted to thank you all for joining us. This is really exciting for us to do.
This is going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah. So, guys, let's start off right now. I want to put a special thanks out for all of you that are joining. But really, I need to give a special thanks out to Garmin. This event is because we don't have Oshkosh this year. And it breaks my heart because Mark and I, how many times have we been to Oshkosh and how many have we missed?
In 20 years, we've never missed an Oshkosh. I've got four sons. Mike's got two daughters and two sons. We've been every single year. And our kids have literally had their diapers changed in soggy tents during Sloshkosh. There's twice we were at Sloshkosh. And we were there all week. We never missed it. We raised our kids with the annual pilgrimage. And this is our chance to still be part of Oshkosh, even though we're not there. And we're so grateful that you decided to join us for this.
We're going to still count this as we made it to Oshkosh, because where would we be at Oshkosh? Well, I've been in the Garmin booth for years, there with Turbulence, there with Draco. And it's one of my favorite times at Oshkosh is to interact with all of you. Well, let's start with what is Scrappy? There's two parts to that question. Scrappy, mechanically, is a Carbon Cub EX3 frame with another Carbon Cub frame that got wrecked that I morphed together and then modified a little bit.
A little bit. Yeah, a few changes.
We strengthened it up everywhere. And so mechanically, it's a Carbon Cub with a carbon fiber structure reinforced to handle an 8-cylinder monster motor. That's mechanically what it is, and we'll kind of talk, spin, tell to the front about that. But more importantly, because that's great, I'm really excited about that. But for me, Scrappy's much bigger than that. Scrappy is the last 14, this is number 14, Draco was 13, aircraft I have built over the last 20 years. And I gathered a bunch of parts along the way, right from motor, frames, components. And I, my wife has a Carbon Cub, and I did it off of Carbon because they have so many components I absolutely love. And it's just like a turnkey toy that it's a traveler or commuter, and it's going to always put grins on your face. So that was my platform.
And their parts are so light. I mean, Cub Crafters did such a great job.
Amazing job. So that's why my wife flies that. All right. Scrappy is more like maybe a monster truck. It's not for everybody. It's really the most impractical bush plane possibly. You know, I don't ever want to grow up. So this is my version of what I would build if I was 5 years old. And I want to spend a little more time because this is Garmin's Oshkosh experience, and we're lucky enough to be here and visit with all of you. So let me show you one of the things I am so excited about. As Scrappy is a little over the top.
A little bit.
Maybe a little bit in a lot of areas. I wanted the panel to be the same. So I want to show you my new panel powered by Garmin and kind of talk a little bit about that real quick, and then you guys can dive into some questions. Right off the bat, I did a 5-screen Garmin system, G3X system, plus a 750. So if you count the screens, there's one more hiding somewhere. So let me go ahead and show you right there. The person in the back seat, and to get in Scrappy for the person in the back seat, that just lifts forward, really easy access, drops back down, So why a screen in the back? Well, quite frankly, it's because when I sit in the back of the plane with my wife, I am harassing her. So I'm always asking, hey, what's your airspeed? Where are we at? How far out are we? So I'm like that five-year-old kid from start to finish. So right off the bat, when I wanted to put this many screens in Scrappy, I just wanted to be able to show everything at once. You know, train, traffic, weather, everything so intuitive. And I wanted to see all the screens up. And real candidly, I also want to have a movie playing over here if I wanted to on a long, long cross country. I can play it here and in the back. But there wasn't a way to do five screen. No one was really that silly, I guess, on how many panels we can put in an aircraft. And so there wasn't an interface. So I called up Garmin. And this is my experience over and over and over through the years, which is why I'm such a huge fan and why I'm happy to be in their booth virtually this year. And it's because I called them up and said, I want to do a fifth screen. And they said, oh, we don't have that option. But if you want it, there might be more people. And they did just what they've done in the past. And they wrote a code and made it possible. So, Mark, you've experienced this. Why don't you talk about
that? I was going to say, it's something we've seen before. And it's not that you can just call Garmin, and anyone can call Garmin and say, I need you to do custom software. But what this shows you is that they listen. They really do more than anybody else. And we saw this in the past when our two race planes, you had a twin turbo Continental 550 and your racer, I had a twin turbo Lycoming 580 cubic inch in my racer. And when we went to eight cylinders after my big engine failure, we wanted a way to watch all eight CHT and all eight EGTs, and that didn't exist out there. And Garmin made that happen for us as well. And so they listen.
Matter of fact, there you go. Eight cylinders, all lit up. So, Garmin, thank you. Sorry.
No, it's just a testament to what kind of a company they are. And I think that's why they found so much success. When you watch them at Oshkosh, you see the guys there and you're like, I know these guys are selling equipment, but I think they're doing market research at the air shows. They're there asking questions, getting feedback, and you'll see the guys go into the back and make notes, and you're like, that's why they're successful. They're listening to the pilots. They're listening to the community.
So Garmin, I'm going to thank you so many times on this. Thank you for listening to all us knucklehead pilots doing fun things in general aviation and adapting to us as well as the big guys and putting these amazing panels in these big super planes. So we're glad you didn't forget the little guys along the way, and you're helping us out. You know what I'd like to do at this point? We've got a screen up. We're counting down our time. Let's go with the first question. I'll try not to trip.
How much suspension travel does Scrappy have?
All right, that's a really easy one. We'll start right at the back of the plane. Scrappy on the tail has over 13 inches of travel. Then it has travel in the leaf spring. So I've got a long ways to go of suspension movement. It's really soft with damping. And then if I go all the way to the bottom, I'll hit a bump stop right down here hiding. That will impact at this point, if I really messed up or crash landed this back end, this will impact this pad. And at that point, it moves into a secondary suspension like a traditional Cub, which is a full traditional leaf spring. And if that continued to fold, this would impact the second bump stop. So 13 inches impact, second set of shocks impact. The front end suspension, why don't you come all the way around? You can kind of get a pulse on this front suspension and kind of climb right under here. There's a twin A-arm system. Pivots are located here. They're off-center on this bar to match the off-center angle of the side of the fuselage. That keeps this tire straight as it goes up and down. It allowed me to take the suspension on Scrappy to 20 and a quarter inches of travel on this gear. And then the next thing that comes up is, how much prop clearance do you have? Well, Scrappy is actually a pretty big bird. And if I take that suspension, somehow hit it to the bottom, which I've done drop testing, we'll show that video soon, it's hard to get it to get there. But if somehow I hit bottom on suspension, at the same time the tail was up, which really actually isn't possible because when the front starts to compress, the tail instantly folds down. But let's assume somehow the tail stayed up and the front bottomed out and I did the worst combination. I still have more prop clearance than a traditional Cub at full bottom, even with 20 and a quarter inches of travel. So that's a long answer to a question. Let's go on to what's next.
The next question was, how Is there any unique interfaces with Scrappy and the G3X Touch?
Yes.
I know where that question's coming from, because there's a few buttons on your panel that are blurred out that I know you're not going to.
Yes, there are some secret interfaces that are coming really soon. We'll talk more about it. And it's because of Garmin I'm able to do something really fun with those interfaces. So things that I've done that is really neat, that's unique to Garmin, is I have the ability to turn on, flip a switch, and turn on a backup camera. I can watch all my flying buddies in formation behind me. I can flip another switch and go straight to night vision and see everything below me and around me if I needed that as an option. And so I interface cameras, and on top of that, I have all kinds of interfaces with extra pressure sensors, switches. I'm able to custom label every single input and gauge, and a few of those have never been put in an airplane before. And we're going
to
show you that.
Multiple fuel cells were easy to put in and calibrate.
Yeah, I mean, I've got everything is simple. The fuel tank that's sitting back here is already calibrated. Matter of fact, it's full of fuel. Why? I haven't started it yet, but I'm really close to making Scrappy Alive videos. So let's go on to another question.
What did you do to protect the carbon? That's a great question, it's really important to talk about.
Yeah, so I'm glad someone actually brought that up. So carbon fiber, if it had direct UV, like I'm doing it here, and was not protected, that carbon fiber could get UV breakdown and weaken that carbon fiber. So there's a couple things we've done, and I did it on a race plane. Mark did it on a race plane over 10 years ago. It's sitting in the hangar next door, and it's perfect still.
Perfect.
It's a really heavy UV blocker. That is for the first stage of protection, because we need to block the sun from getting to the layers. So just in case that UV somehow broke down, they claim it's a 30, 50-year life, but, you know, in
it's
aviation,
an airplane.
It's an airplane. We don't hope that that's right. We plan on it not. So there's an extra layer of carbon fiber beyond what I needed for structure that is just to block out the sun from the actual integrity part of the carbon fiber below it. So it's like a sacrificial spare layer, added a little more weight. I added UV clear blocker on top of that. And then one step further, and I'll let Mark talk a little bit about this, but you'll notice that most of the front section of Scrappy doesn't have carbon fiber, nor does it have very many screws all over it. And back here, you see a lot more attach points in the flat rigid area. I want the strength. And back here in the arching area, I have movement. I didn't attach it. So go ahead and talk
about really the purpose of that, why you see so many more screws here, it's more about the color. It's more about the temperatures. This sits out on the ramp. Composites get soft. Cirrus Aircraft have been really the wizards in finding out and testing and determining what composites can get up to what temperatures. So when you see a Cirrus aircraft, the paint colors are selected. They have certain colors that can be on the wing, certain colors that can't be on the wing, how much of the wing can be colored in certain darknesses of material. So once we come back here, what's a little bit different is that we've got a lot more screws to keep everything together, but the composite in this section of the plane isn't so much a structural. It adds structural strength, but the real structural integrity is what's been done to the frame. So it is a tube, chromoly tube frame, and that's where the structure is, and this adds strength, but you don't have to rely on it. So this could be very hot and be a little softer in the heat and still be safe. That's something you couldn't do in an all-composite plane, go that dark.
Yeah, I wouldn't go that dark, all-composite. Okay, what's another question we got here?
So, from Ahmed, how high do you think Scrappy will fly?
Without a doubt, 25,000 feet is where I'm setting my tag, and that has to do with oxygen, not how much horsepower can Scrappy take me, because I guarantee 25,000 is easy, because I've flown this engine above 25,000 feet with an itty-bitty wing, and this is going to have a monster wing and way more power than I did it at that time.
Yeah.
So, you know, technically, well north of 30,000 feet without a problem. What I'm setting my limit at, 25,000 feet.
25,000 gives you the margin you want.
Yep, and I've built in pulse oxygen delivery from the front seat and the back seat.
Yep.
Also in my Garmin panel, they interfaced a way to take a digital reader, and I literally, me and the back seat, we have our own socket. We plug our finger in. It pulls up our oxygen and heart rate onto our Garmin screens for either one of us and populates it on the respective screen. So we always know what our oxygen is. We have built-in oxygen on the panel. Yep. So thanks for that interface, Garmin.
All right, Dan has a question. He says, what are the total man hours at this point in Scrappy? I already know the answer to that one.
Yeah, guys.
We've never counted on any aircraft.
I can honestly say my closest guess is thousands of hours. I don't know what the number
is. Give or take a thousand or two hours.
I don't track the hours because it's
that
like...
That would take time away from building.
Yeah,
I mean, if someone had to get a spreadsheet and write it down, you could have put a bolt in.
That's right. So
I don't know. I'll get the next question from Joe. What do you expect some of the specs to be like stole performance?
Stole performance. That's a big question, and I'm shooting for a similar stole performance as a current carbon cub.
And I think that's realistic.
It's realistic. Scrappy is not built to be
a competition plane.
It may look like it, and it's got motor to do it, but this is about, along the way, I had to decide, am I building a competition plane, or am I building the plane I want, or what I would have built as a five-year-old, just
right.
giving it anything I want and doing it for the fun of aviation. And so Carbon Cub is a really good baseline because... out of the box, you buy a plane, and it can
that's
go out and
competition
compete, competition worthy, and go head to head with super modifieds,
yeah.
and be relatively competitive.
Aaron has another question. Are you planning to fly Scrappy for search and rescue missions? Well, yeah, absolutely.
So Mark and I, it's almost like yes.
Yeah.
So
15 plus years now, we've been flying search and rescue.
So we've been flying every one of our planes. Draco's been out. Our helicopter's been out. All of our planes going way back. We've been doing search and rescue. And quite frankly, Scrappy is not going to have a mid door here. It's going to be all glass all the way down. And a lot of that had to do specifically with search and rescue. Being able to see straight down on both sides, loiter in the mid 30 mile an hour range, and spot people is going to be one of the best search and rescue tools ever. And quite frankly, there's been a lot of times we've had our planes out and we found the person unconscious. We don't know if they're even alive and we can't get to them for hours. Quite frankly, there's going to be places on mountaintops that some of our blast aircraft couldn't even get high enough to see them up at 16,000 feet, DA of 18, 19,000 feet. And Scrappy is going to still have 400 horsepower at that altitude, and we can stick it on a mountaintop, maybe get to them a little faster. So I plan on using Scrappy a lot. So thanks for that question. It's really important to us.
You know, as you're talking about the emergencies and the things we've seen, one of my favorite parts about this whole panel, and I know you got all this glass, and you got all this stuff going on, but for me, my favorite instrument is probably that G5. Because I was earlier in my flying days a little more timid to tell controllers what I needed them to do, and had my Lancer Legacy hit by lightning when I was waiting to get permission to turn around. And I lost a lot of avionics and a little backup instrument that didn't go when everything else goes. That's a big deal for me. And the nice thing about that little G5 is that the backup battery on it, it's completely independent. It's not even like a wire harness that goes somewhere to some other battery you hope you hooked up right. If you want the backup battery, you just plug it in and turn it on.
I've done that, Mark. I couldn't agree more. So if you guys are thinking about a panel, I don't care if you're doing a basic panel, an old school six pack, that G5...
It doesn't weigh anything either.
It's extremely lightweight. It's everything in one. I mean, we're at a Garmin event, so I want to pitch Garmin, but this is just my personal firm belief. That is something every panel should have in it. So let's go on to another question. What do we got?
Okay, from Adam. What stage are the wings at?
Fantastic. They're on a computer, and a lot of it's designed, and I actually have some unique... it's crazy. I'm trying to try something a little different. We'll see how it works
out. That's not like you.
It's never happened before. So on the wings, it's in the computer. A lot of the components are designed, but there's hundreds of them. Here's the challenge with Scrappy. I could put on a Carbon Cub wing, and it's such a good performing wing. I could bolt it on, add some spar doublers, get the weight up to handle the weight of Scrappy, and I could go fly it. But the plane's so much heavier, I wouldn't get the performance I need. I could go look at getting a wing off of Draco. I could get a wing off of Cessna, and I could get things close and make it fly well. I'll have every stitch of leather in this plane, every single part, panel, leather, fuel. I will have it running on this ramp and kind of drive it around through the ruts, test the suspension, then I'll get its final weight. I am really within a few, I'm really close. I got a little lucky this time and really got close on the weight. Then I will match the wing loading for that plane. Then I will finish the design. So wing is dead last. So,
yeah.
All right, next question. What do we got?
Okay, so where's the throttle? We like these quick, easy questions.
Cool. Right here on the way over on the left side, where these two wires are coming out, throttle and mixture right over there. So right-hand center, left hand, like most Cubs originally. I'm a lot more familiar with the other hand.
Yeah.
But I fly both. My racers have always been this way.
Yep.
Draco, my bush planes are always this way. They feel the same, so that's the throttle way on the left.
All right, so we'll get some more questions. Explain how well the EIS works with an 8-cylinder power plant.
I have these other mods that are coming that I needed more inputs and more interfaces, and so I got another and pairs up, and the screen can be programmed for all that stuff. So
you're not going to say what the system is.
No. It's coming soon. Okay. But all of you guys know I'm doing some different things.
Okay, so. A question from Travis. Are you using Garmin AOA?
My wife's Cub doesn't have AOA. I'm going to go ahead and install a Garmin's AOA system in it. When it first came out, it was just kind of different.
But we had never been used to it.
We grew up on steam gauges our whole life. So one, the first time I tried a Garmin AOA, and then I went up and did the test flight program with it and set up the stall and when the wing breaks, and I dialed it all in. And then I came in to land, and I'm landing the normal way I always want to land the plane. And it's coming alive and showing the colors and arrows and green, yellow, red. And, man, it's the coolest safety feature ever. So I am using a Garmin AOA. All right, next question. Matt, what an epic aircraft. Thank you.
Would you mass produce it?
No. So, I think that's...
It's such a compliment,
and it makes me so happy, and thank you for that, Matt. So I think Scrappy is more the Baja Desert trophy truck and a monster truck, and it's
and
about,
you would produce a Ford F-150.
You produce the normal truck. You don't really produce the other.
If I
was going to buy a plane, well, I know what I do. I bought my wife a Carbon Cub. This is just going to extreme. Sure, it's going to do some things that other planes may not be able to do, and then there'll be other areas where these lightweight Cubs are going to beat Scrappy. But this is just what I want. And, you know, I kind of want to talk a little bit about why I'm willing to do something kind of so left field that I kind of tend to do it a lot. This one, I really thought hard about how do I share my passion best with aviation. And it's to just do something that will maybe get out of aviation, if that makes sense. I noticed something that happened with Draco when all of a sudden I'm receiving literally hundreds of emails and messages that
from non-pilots.
Non-pilots that didn't know a pilot, never knew you can just go get a pilot's license. What ended up happening is they come and say, I found you on a monster truck forum. I found you on a drag racing forum. And now I have my pilot's license. And I thought, you know what? What can we do to do more of that? Aviation is my family. So Scrappy's more about let's let the world see what can be done and what happens if you don't stay in the conformities of natural, normal processes of build. And let's see how far we can go. And just maybe some of the crazy suspension ideas or safety ideas will, if we're lucky enough, will leak out. But it's because of all of those people that the back of this plane is actually all clear carbon fiber with 500, just shy of 500 names wrapped around this belly. Every magazine I loved growing up, every single company from Garmin and Pratt & Whitney and Lycoming Engines and all these companies that have supported me along the way.
And even
I wanted to say
groups.
Thanks.
I mean, I'm just looking at them like you got the Fat Tire Cowboys on there. Such a great group of guys. Stole Rats, you know, Plane and Pilot Magazine. Of course, Flying Cowboys are on there.
We got our Aussies in Australia, Bush Flyers down under here. Basically, I thought I want to build a plane that is just for fun. That is just unique enough to kind of say thanks to everyone and just share my love of aviation. So I put the names on it, and we'll see how it seems to be received well.
The next question is a great one. I think they probably noticed on the panel you've got a full Garmin autopilot control head. Autopilots and Cubs, you just don't see that often. It's getting more and more popular. But you did something nobody else has really done with a Cub that we know of. Yeah. Why don't we show them that?
I don't know if you guys can follow me around.
So the question was, does your autopilot have yaw dampen?
Yeah, so I don't know if you can see all the way back around this backside at all. But normally the cables are connected down here. They still are. If you look right here, this carbon fiber solid bar coming through here has a gust lock that locks it. But this is my yaw damp control. So I have a large tail, should keep that Cub from kind of waving as some Cubs do in the bumps. But what's great is on the Garmin autopilot, I can turn that on, and I experienced it in my racer at over 440 miles an hour. I hit that on, and it can react faster than you can. And I don't mean by a little. It is right now.
It's corrected.
It is corrected.
We're aware of the yaw.
And so when you hit the bumps, you just kind of lose that little swing that sometimes gets the person in the back seat a little bit woozy.
Yeah.
So I've got a yaw damp on it. Thanks for asking.
So next question, have you ever considered building an electric plane?
There probably will be a day I do electric. I don't have it on a calendar. I've gone so far as to pair two 400 horsepower electric motors together to make an 800 horsepower electric aircraft engine. And we already made and tooled designed the gearbox assembly to go on the front of it to step the gear down to handle a propeller. So for me, 800 horsepower of electric in a Stoll drag plane. Well, if I was building a plane just for Stoll drag racing,
it would probably be
700 pounds, not closer to 2,000 pounds. It'd be 600 to 700 pounds with 800 horsepower, counter-rotating propellers, and it would be built just for Stoll drag. So Scrappy is more
not
for
that.
My touring Alaska
yeah.
monster truck.
All right, so the next question comes from Helen. How's Mark's plane coming along? Helen, that's a great question. For over a year, I haven't touched it, which has been heartbreaking, but it needed to happen. Best Hugs has been growing exponentially. We've seen record sales month over month. In fact, we've been very fortunate that Best Hugs has continued to see record sales month all the way through this COVID crisis. So we're very grateful. But as a result of that, we had to build a new factory. So we're trying to manage a growing company. I was the general contractor on our large new factory and facility. We had to get it tooled and equipped and permitted and concrete. That was a full-time job and a full-time job building the factory.
And he was building his house, so.
Yeah, so.
That was a long answer to a question. The answer is he just in the last
just
week,
started.
Almost 2 weeks ago, dove in and he has been kicking butt.
We're making some progress now.
Mark's plane is coming really soon. So I had another question that I skipped over. What's the black plate then? I'm going to give you two answers. The real answer and then the five-year-old in me answer, because my five-year-old often wins what I'm doing to my airplane just because. So this plate is an arced aluminum plate that ties into a super W-web substructure inside the aircraft that is for a pair of floats. My dream is to take this, put it on a big set of floats, and land on some lakes that nobody has ever landed on before, because they're so high and they're a glacier lake on a snow peak that if a plane got on it, they'd never get back off it, and therefore they haven't been done. And I kind of want to just land on those lakes with Scrappy, pull up to somewhere that no one's ever maybe possibly even set foot before, so far back and remote, and know that I can safely wind up 13-inch wide paddles on a four-blade prop and over 500 horsepower and get it off.
Now the five-year-old
answer.
So
that is my float. What's my five-year-old answer? The five-year-old answer is it was real easy to just add another bar or two in there, so why not do it for added strength? I could put a little pod coming out and a couple little rockets on each side, little mini jets. I don't know that I'll ever do it, but that five-year-old got in my head, and I thought, I think that'd be pretty fun. So it's pretty far ahead of the tail section. It's really close to its center of thrust line, so its controllability would be easy. So I thought, I gotta at least maybe consider it. Who knows what happens years down the road? I might do something my five-year-old wants.
I would bet on it.
So let me tell all of you that joined us. We're wrapping it up here.
I kind of feel like I missed so many things I want to talk about. We'll try and answer more on the questions. I'm going to take all these Q&A and I'm going to roll them into the next video. I'll try and talk about that online or maybe put it in an upcoming video. First and foremost, all of you that joined us, thank you very much. Sharing the passion of aviation with us. Letting us share a piece of Oshkosh virtual Garmin booth with you today. Garmin, thank you. Garmin, you guys are the best for putting this together. And I think we're going to wrap it up here. Love all you guys. Love aviation. Don't forget, go do something nice for someone you don't know. Because if you're a selfish person, it's still going to make you happy inside. Let's be good to others.
Yep. All right, that's it. Thanks so much, Garmin. Mike, what do you say?
Get back to work. Hey guys, I hope you liked that little Q&A live with Garmin. We sure had a lot of fun doing it. I'm gonna try and do question and answers at the end of my videos. Maybe not every video, but quite a bit. So what I'm gonna do is go through and read all of your comments and the questions you have for me. And I'll go through and grab the ones that I see come up the most, and then I'll answer those questions on the video. So please write down your comments, your questions you might have. I'll go through them. We'll hit them on another video. We'll see you soon. I'm getting back to work.